Sine waves are the most important AC waveform, since they are the basis for all other AC waveforms. Unfortunately, a sine wave by itself isn't the most easy to generate, unlike something like a square wave. Well, in this video, I've put together several different circuits that you can use to generate sine waves of your own. So without further ado, let's dive in. Like I said in the intro, sine waves aren't the easiest to generate, but square waves are. I mean, something as simple as an A-stable 555 timer circuit could do the trick. Let's take a look at the frequency makeup of a 50 kHz square wave. To do this, we can pull up the FFT on an oscilloscope. And as you can see, the first frequency is at 50 kHz, which is the fundamental frequency. Afterwards, you'll see several harmonics which diminish in amplitude as they go on. Each of these markers represents a sine wave frequency that is present in the square wave signal. If we want to retrieve the fundamental frequency's sine wave, we just need to filter out all the higher frequency components. Let's take a look at the basic low-pass RC filter. If we use a 3 nanofarad capacitor and a 1 kilo ohm resistor, we get a cutoff frequency of 53 kHz, which is higher than the fundamental frequency of our square wave, but still lower than all of those harmonics. As you can see from the output of our filter, it isn't exactly a sine wave. This is because our RC filter doesn't have that steep of a cutoff. Let's instead take a look at an LC low-pass filter. These filters have a steeper cutoff, so we should get a little more sine-like shape on the output. Let's use an inductor of 470 microhenry and a 22 nanofarad capacitor. As you can see, the resulting sine wave is much better than the one that we got from the RC filter. If you wanted to improve things even more, you could add another filter or two to better select the filtered frequency. Unfortunately, this filtering method isn't the greatest for a selectable frequency, since you'd have to dynamically adjust the filter based on the input frequency. We aren't done with those low-pass RC filters yet. Each RC filter comes with an output phase shift thanks to the complex impedance. If you don't know what I mean, let's take a look at this specific filter, which has a 560 ohm resistor and a 10 nanofarad capacitor. Let's pass in a 50 kHz sine wave to the input, and as you can see, the output does not align with the input, and it's been shifted. At this specific frequency, 50 kHz, the sine wave gets shifted by roughly 60 degrees. You can find the phase shift of an RC low-pass filter with this equation. Arctangent of 2 pi frequency, resistance times capacitance. All this talk about phase shifts is important because we can use it in a sine wave oscillator. If we chain three of those RC filters together, we can get an oscillator. If we add a common emitter amplifier, we now have a complete oscillator. If you don't know what a common emitter amplifier is, I recommend that you watch my previous video about BJT transistors. Anyways, you can now see how the circuit forms an oscillator by looking at the phase shifts. The three RC filters in series have a combined phase shift of 180 degrees at the oscillation frequency. The BJT amplifier has a phase shift of 180 degrees itself. This means that we will get a complete phase shift of 360 degrees from input to output, which is the same as 0 degrees. Other frequencies will not have that 180 degree phase shift through those filters, which means that the amplifier will amplify those frequencies at the wrong time, which over time will cause them to diminish. If we use three of those filters, we get an output frequency of 58.7 kHz. Not too shabby. We can also make an op-amp version. For this test, I used the TL072 op-amp. As a quick side note, if you are in need of a negative and positive supply, you can wire the other op-amp on the package to act as a virtual ground. Anyways, I have it wired in an inverted configuration to give us a phase shift of 180 degrees on the amplifier. I'd also like to point out that the input resistor to the op-amp has a dual purpose of being part of the RC filter and also the op-amp's amplification stage. A 68K feedback resistor is enough to make the circuit oscillate. With all of this, we get an output of 31.9 kHz. And I'd say that this is a rather handsome sine wave considering the simplicity of the circuit. And as one final note regarding phase shift oscillators, you don't have to use RC low-pass filters. You can really use anything that has a phase shift. You could use an RC high-pass filter or an RL filter. you may also have four filter stages instead of just three. The possibilities are seemingly endless. The Weinberg oscillator is another type of oscillator that relies on resistor and capacitor filters. It's often drawn in a bridge shape, which is why it's called the Wein bridge. It can be a bit confusing to look at it like this though, so let me break it down for you. For now, let's just focus on the two important bits of the bridge. The top half is the series resistor and a capacitor, and the lower half is a parallel resistor and a capacitor. These components together form a sort of filter as well. And just like the phase shift oscillator from before, we are targeting a specific phase shift. This time around, we are looking for the frequency at which the phase shift is 0 degrees. We can solve for it by looking at the configuration as an impedance divider, similar to a resistive divider. We can combine each pair of resistor and capacitor into a single impedance, with R1 and C1 being in series with each other, and R2 and C2 being in parallel. We can make a simplification, where both resistances are the same, and both capacitances are the same. And after quite a bit of algebra, we arrive at this equation. The frequency of oscillation is 1 over 2 pi RC. And at that specific frequency, we get a gain of 1/3. Now, let's attach this to our op-amp, which again is the TL072. You'll notice the two other resistors, which determine the gain on our non-inverting op-amp. These two resistors are the ones we initially neglected on the Wein bridge. Either way, the selection of the resistors is difficult. Remember how I said that the gain of the Wein bridge filters is 1/3? Well, that means that our op-amp will have to have a gain of 3 in order to cancel out those losses and maintain oscillation. Unfortunately, if you have too much gain, you will basically get a square wave on the output. It is far too difficult to get an exactly matched resistor for this case. The most popular workaround for this is a light bulb. I unfortunately don't have a suitable one with me, but the idea is that the light bulb will increase its resistance when heating up, and it will decrease after cooling. This should lead to an equilibrium where gain is precisely chosen by the light bulb. Luckily, there are ways that you can do this without getting a light bulb, the most practical of which is by using a JFET. A JFET, in its linear region, acts like a voltage-controlled resistor. So, what we can do is set up a negative peak detecting circuit with a diode and a large capacitor. When the negative peak grows larger, it is stored in the capacitor, and the JFET becomes more resistive. This causes the peak to diminish and therefore reduces the resistance. Ideally, after some time and the long RC constant, we should arrive at some sort of equilibrium. The result that I achieved works decently well. The Wein bridge can be very stable and clean if you set it upright, but that is very difficult to do. Perhaps you could get better performance with a proper PCB and a different design. Let's take a look at a different kind of oscillator, the one which involves an inductor and a capacitor. I've brought you to the simulator to demonstrate what ideal behavior looks like. This configuration that we have here is often called an LC tank. Ideally, a parallel capacitor and inductor will shift their stored energy between each other. The frequency of the shift is given by the equation F equals 1 over 2 pi square root LC. And ideally, they will continue this balancing act forever. However, real life is not ideal, and there will be parasitic resistances. This resistance will absorb some of the energy, and it will be enough to eventually dampen the oscillation out. In order to maintain the oscillation, we can add energy back into the LC tank in phase with the oscillation. There is a very famous circuit that we can use for this, the Colpitts oscillator. From the schematic, you can find the LC tank. And as you can see, the capacitor is divided up into two parts. This is very important, since this forms the basis of our feedback. The signals on each capacitor will be opposite one another, and the ratio of the size of the capacitors determines just how large the base signal will be. The other oddity in the circuit is L1, the collector inductor. This is often labeled as an RF choke on many versions of this circuit. And from personal experience, this component makes it much, much easier to get the system to oscillate. Unfortunately, it does contribute to the resonant frequency. So make sure to take that into consideration if you need a precise frequency. Taking a look at the output, we can see that we are getting a 400 kHz oscillating sine wave with some distortion. Let me introduce to you a parallel to the Colpitts oscillator, the Hartley oscillator. It's basically the same thing as the Colpitts, but it splits up the inductor instead of the capacitor. I'd still recommend the Colpitts over the Hartley though in most cases, since it's much easier to split up a capacitor, and it's a little bit easier to work with. But weigh up your options as needed and determine what's best for your circuit. Let's take a look at an op-amp version. As you can see, the basic shape is still here. The LC tank is still divided up in the capacitors. On the output, we get a 180 kHz output. It's worth noting that the input of the op-amp has a much prettier sine wave in the case that you'd like to use that instead of the one on the output. You can also try to smooth the output of the op-amp by placing limiting diodes on the input as well. With this, we get a new frequency of 216 kHz, but it comes with increased distortion. Let's take a look at crystal oscillators. And, well, they aren't all that different from the LC oscillators. Here's the equivalent circuit diagram of a crystal. It is basically a series resistor, inductor, and capacitor, all in parallel with a capacitor. Just like the LC circuits from before, a crystal will oscillate at a specific resonant frequency. For the following circuits, I will be using a 4 MHz crystal. The first design is a classic crystal oscillator circuit. R1 biases the resonant elements, and the two capacitors are split up to provide feedback to the transistor. The transistor will apply power in phase with the feedback given by the capacitors. The output from the circuit is distorted, but it is 4 MHz on the dot, which is certainly a good thing when you want the exact frequency as printed on the crystal. It isn't always like that though. Let's take a look at a modified Colpitts oscillator, which uses a common base amplifier. The resonant elements are all still here, and we get a sine output. However, the important thing that I want you to pay attention to is the frequency. We are getting 6.56 MHz on the output. So, just keep in mind that the crystal is not guaranteed to oscillate at its printed frequency, and other circuit elements may very well adjust the resonant frequency. Let's take a look at just one more crystal oscillator. It's a JFET version of a Pierce oscillator. I'd say that this is the best crystal oscillator circuit of the three that we tested. The output is a clean 4 MHz sine wave with decently low distortion. The only drawback is the annoyingly high voltage needed. 22 volts. Well, that's just about cover it for sine wave oscillators. If you've learned something new, please consider subscribing so that you can see my future videos. Also, visit my Buy Me a Coffee page. With your support, I can keep making these videos. I'd like to take a moment to thank Mr. Dev Null and Cognizant for being longtime channel members. Anyways, thanks for watching. Have a good one.